in the test and set, the atomic function, the lock is initially false. Okay, so it was, I think I have updated this while talking about this. Initially, there is no lock. So the first thread comes here, sets the lock to true, and it returns the original value, which is false. So it escapes from the while loop and it does the critical section. So now lock is true. So when the second thread comes, it will return whatever the input here, which is true. So while true happens, so the second thread cannot enter here. This is the first mechanism. Second mechanism was the swap tactic. Again, lock is initially false. So the first thread key is true. The first thread will make lock true because I swap key and lock. So this is true now and key is false. So with the false key, I escape from the while loop and first thread is inside. Then the second thread comes. But unfortunately, lock was made true here. So the second thread will swap true with true. So it is like an ineffective action. So it will just repeat here forever. Not forever, until the first thread sets lock equal to false. At that time, when the turns come to the second thread, it will see lock as false. So it will replace key with false. And the true of key makes the lock true. So since key is false, I don't do any while loop. The second thread is now in action, and so on. Now I will go to a mechanism that is more efficient, okay? Because all of these actions require some kind of idle waiting. It is called busy waiting, or also known as spin lock. So in the Peterson algorithm, we have observed that if this is the condition, then I do nothing, okay? So while this do nothing and semicolon. Okay, so it is like A equal to A, something like some unnecessary action that just spends time in the CPU by doing nothing. Or in the test and sets case, again, this empty statement here. Now, how to avoid this? If a process calls this system call called wait on a semaphore, so this is going to be an object. So if the semaphore's value is zero at that time, then that process gets blocked, okay? So it is the state of the process or thread, whatever, it is now waiting. So it is not ready anymore. It goes to the waiting queue, so it releases the CPU back to me. Instead of just doing idle actions here, it just gives up the CPU, which is a very wonderful thing because I have to wait anyway. So why am I bothering the CPU with unnecessary or stupid actions like idle actions? The state of process is switched to waiting state and the control is transferred to the scheduler, which selects another process, maybe a totally irrelevant process, so it can safely use the CPU. Or it can select the one that is already inside the critical section. When another process increments the semaphore, so wait is the decrement function, like blocking function, and signal is the unblocking function. Okay, so these are working together. When the other process increments the semaphore by calling signal, so this has nothing to do with our previous signal, by the way, just signal. And there are tasks on the queue. So it means that I am done. So signal, like wake up, some other thing, some other process waiting on the current semaphore. So we will learn the wait and signal pair, but sometimes they call it down and up. Okay, sometimes they call it P and V, where these are the initials for some German or Dutch word for increment and decrement. But again, let's stick with wait and signal. So here is now your new coding environment, I will call wait on the semaphore S. If it allows me, I will enter the critical section, and when I leave, I will call the signal on S. And again, kernel makes sure that these functions are atomic, so it will not be, they won't be interrupted. So what are these functions, if you ask? Here are those functions. I can implement wait function using the busy waiting tactic, but then it defeats the purpose because I want the blocking effect, not the busy waiting. But if you are curious, let me show you how to implement it. So if semaphore has the value of zero currently, then do nothing, just busy wait, and not make it negative. Okay. Not negative, but decrease it by one, and signal is just increases it by one, and this is the initial value. But more important and better implementation is like this. The semaphore structure object comes, it has a value, so assume it is currently an integer, but it also has a linked list, but assume that this is just an integer now. So decrease it by one. Initially this is one, okay, the value is one, integer one. If you decrease it by one, S becomes zero, so no problem, I don't block, I continue. But if the semaphore is currently zero, then this becomes negative, so I block that process. So semaphore is now minus one. While I already have that thread in my queue or in my block list, maybe another thread comes, it makes S equal to minus two, and it also gets blocked. Then the third one comes, it makes it a minus three and minus four and so on. So I can block like 10 or 20, as many threads as I want here, as long as S is negative. So then what happens is, assume that S is minus seven, which means that I have seven threads in my blocked, in my linked list, attached to this semaphore. So when seven threads are waiting, the current thread, say T0, has finished its task, so it calls signal. So minus seven becomes minus six now, and it becoming negative or zero means that something is definitely waiting in the queue. So just wake some of them, one of them. This is arbitrary. And in general, we use first in, first out. So the first blocked, it now wakes up. Okay, so this is the whole idea. Now, let's actually, I am now just talking about this like I described. So again, if S is initially one, if you call wait on one, you don't wait because S becomes zero and you don't block. Okay. But if S is zero, means that I already have one thing in my critical section. So now S becomes minus one, and now you deserve to be blocked because you are a negative. And minus one means I have one thing in my block, blocking queue or block linked list. So when the signal is called, now I increase S. And if there is someone in the blocking part, which is detected by this condition, I wake it up. I wake the most recent one up. And signal is the same idea. I discussed them together. So you can, depending on your values on your semaphore, if you only take 0 and 1, then you have a binary semaphore. For some synchronization problems like resource allocation, we want any numbers on semaphores. Then we have a counting semaphore. So example here is for counting semaphore. So the semaphore is actually is a struct in C which has a value like 0 or 1 or minus 7, whatever. And it also has a linked list of processes that are waiting on this semaphore. And as I discussed before, when process X is executing wait, okay, so X is inside here, then wait can only execute wait if X has finished, obviously, or maybe X hasn't finished, but X comes to the block. So X is still inside this function, but it is in the blocked condition. Okay, so that's why this is the way they work, actually. And similarly, when X is in the signal function, Y can only execute signal function if X is finished. So this is atomic. No two are in the same function, actively in the same function at the same time. So this is our very first example with the semaphores. What I do here is I have a semaphore called mutex, so you can use any name, obviously. It can be shared by n processes, and initially it is one, so it will allow the first process to come in. So here is your general structure. So let's see this in action. I have my mutex of type semaphore. This is initialized to one. Now I will assume that process zero wants to come in. So the same code will be executed by first process or the second process or thread. You can treat them any way you want. So assume that P0 is here. So I call a wait on mutex, so it becomes zero now. But I am not affected. I come to the critical section and assume that I go out, so I signal it, so mutex becomes one again. So later, when one process one comes, it will see one, it will make it zero, do the work, and it will make it one again. So this is the version without any interleaving. Let's do some interleaving. Process zero comes, mutex becomes zero, because I decrease it only one. Now mutex is zero, okay? Assume that process one is in the scheduler now, in the CPU now. So I want to wait on a zero. Okay, waiting on a zero is terrible. You will be blocked because zero minus one will be a negative. So you will be blocked. Okay, you won't be here for your process one. And later, when I signal the process zero, it will make semaphore equal to one. And it will wake someone from this queue. Currently, only process one was in the queue, so it will enter the critical section. And by the way, kernel, as we discussed in the semaphore queue, there are many threads in the queue. Obviously, you need to use a FIFO action, like first in first out. If you use LIFO, last in first out, like the stack tactic, then the one you have blocked first will start to death probably, because you will never reach that thread, assuming new threads are always coming. So a fair mechanism is to use FIFO here. Here is another synchronization problem to you. So far, I was dealing with handling the critical section. Okay, what is that? Updating a shared global. Okay, so this was about critical section handling. Now the problem is totally different. I want S1 to be executed before S2. Okay, so I want to guarantee this. Obviously, if these are sequential threads or processes, then there is no problem. Obviously, S1 will execute before S2, because this is the law of physics, this is above this. But in my case, I am doing this pseudo parallel execution. So how do you guarantee that S1 executes before S2? Let's think about it for a second. And this is important because maybe S1 is calling a function which eventually sets an index like to a non-negative value, like to 7. And in the S2, maybe I am calling another function that is using an array with that index. So if you call S2 before S1, that index can be like minus 1, okay, uninitialized. So S2 will fail because the index is not good. So you want to ensure that S1 will execute before S2. So here is my solution to you then. Basically, I do the following. I start the semaphore with 0. So be careful. So far, I was always using 1 here. Now, in this problem, I will use 0. Because assume that the scheduler first wants to run P1. But luckily, wait on 0 will cause a blocking, as we know. Because 0 minus 1 is a negative thing, so you will be blocked. So even if the turn is here, you will be blocked. Block means your process state is not ready anymore. It is, your state is a waiting state. So you are automatically in a preemptive scheduling algorithm. You are kicked out of the CPU. And now P0 comes to the CPU. It executes S1 just like I want. S1 executes, so it executes before S2. Now I am ready to handle S2. So I just update the semaphore to 1 up. Remember it was minus 1 before. Now it has become 0. But not only that, when if you recall the signal action, okay, so S became 0, meaning that okay, it is not negative, non-negative, it is something not positive, 0 included. So I wake up a process in the queue. In my example, there is only one process, so it is not a queue even. So you just wake up this guy, which executes S2 now. Yes, so this is a nice synchronization task. Another problem for you, okay, resource allocation. Assume that you have N processes and they want a resource that has 5 instances only, okay? So how do you coordinate them? How do you coordinate N processes so that they can live with only 5 printers or 5 memories, whatever? In this case, your semaphore will begin at numbers 5. Again, not 1 or not 0, but 5. So the idea is the following. Every process that wants to use resource will do a wait on RS resource. So remember, every wait will do 1 minus minus. So the RS value will become 0 after 5 calls. It means that first 5 process will get your resource and do its thing, whatever. It will still be doing its thing. But when now the 6th process comes, okay, 6 came, what happens is, what happens is it will be blocked because now the semaphore will be minus 1, something negative. Okay, so it will be blocked and it will wait for a signal to be awakened. And so remember, I had 5 different threads. Maybe thread 2 has a little thing to do with that resource. Okay, so thread 2 will finish early. So thread 2 will call a signal, so it will wake thread 6 up. Because it was in the blocking linked list or the blocking queue, FIFO queue. Yeah, so every process that finishes R will do a signal. And so I don't have the code for this, but I think it is very clear from this explanation. I have a code for another task which we discussed before. It is the producer-consumer problem. You need to enforce consumer to sleep while there is no item to consume in the buffer. Okay, so what you do is the following. You have this semaphore called full cells. You can call anything. Currently, full is zero. So it is not full. Like, you can read it like this. But zero is like empty, actually. So hopefully it was four. It means that I had four items. But unfortunately, I have zero items. So full cells is zero. So when I call await on zero, it will block, as we know. And again, it will not do some stupid busy waiting. It will rather leave the CPU and go to its waiting state kindly. It will just wait for some signal to come. Okay, so what is that signal? Here is that signal. Only the producer thread is able to create that signal, because it will use the same semaphore with the consumer, so they are coordinated. So if you produce one item, then full cells becomes zero again. Remember, it has became minus one here, so it became zero again. It is here, it is consuming it, but maybe then six more production appeared, so I just increased it six times. So it means that I have six items in my array, so I can handle six additional consume calls, because the negativity will appear in the seventh call. Okay, so this is the logic. I hope it is clear. And so here is a graph about this buffer size. So if you hit the maximum buffer size, then you need to put producer to sleep. And if you have zero buffer size, like zero content, you need to put consumer to sleep, like block, I mean, by sleep. And so there is this behavior between them. Again, this is not quite relevant here. I am just putting some visualization. So now with synchronization, I think you understand, you are convinced that semaphore is the best way to go so far, because it avoids busy waiting. But there's a problem, which is called deadlock. Maybe you have heard this word, but it is a very critical problem in the operating systems world. Because two or more processes will be waiting indefinitely forever for an event that can be caused by only one of the waiting processes. Okay, so there is a paradox here. For instance, P1 wants to use resource 1, and it already has resource 2. Okay, so this insight means R2 belongs to P1. But P1 wants additional R1. However, R1 is currently in use by P2, and P2 is able to release it so that P1 can use it, but P2 is blocked because P2 wants R2 now. However, R2 is occupied by P1, which is also blocked. So let me put it again, because this is kind of philosophically complicated, but it is not actually. So both processes need resources to continue execution, as we know. So P1 here requires R1, which is currently in possession of R2. Yeah, P1 also has R2, but it requires R1. However, P2 requires R2 to continue, but R2 can only be given by P1, but P1 will not be able to do that because P1 is currently blocked on R1. Okay, so there is some this sick cycle happening. Here is another way to look at the problem, where we have processes represented as cars and resources as roads. Okay, so This process already has the horizontal rod. It wants the vertical rod. But vertical rod cannot be released by the other process because it wants another rod which cannot be given to it currently. So there is a deadlock, means a forever wait. And actually this is something that can happen in real life as well. So maybe these cards are still in this configuration, we can't know, but there are ways to break deadlocks. So what is one way? For instance, you give up the resource. But giving up something you need will probably cause you to fail or crash. Your code will not be valid anymore. So in this scenario, maybe this car and this car, these guys, they just exit. Okay, they release this resource. So they will now continue. And once they are gone, they will continue. So some sort of sacrifice will be necessary to handle deadlocks. Or another way is to prevent deadlocks. So you can prevent your system to come into this position in the first place. So we will talk more about deadlocks next week, actually. But this is something that goes with synchronization. Here are the wrong usages of semaphores that will give you some deadlocks. Okay, so it looks cool. Now let's come back to the programming world. So if you do the following action in the first process and the following action in the second process, then you will have a trouble. What is that? So I wait on S. Okay, so currently S is available. I continue. And I wait on Q, which is currently available. So I don't block. I do my thing and I increase S, I increase Q, and then this process gets executed. This waits on Q, but no problem because Q was already safe. And then S then does the critical section and then signals them out. So no deadlock in that configuration. But consider the following configuration. I execute this statement, okay, wait on S. And here scheduling has happened. So scheduler asks P1 to run. So P1 now goes and it calls wait on Q. Okay, so Q becomes minus 1 now. Okay, Q is minus 1. So if this tries to continue, it will be blocked. Because S was already minus 1 due to this part. It will be blocked forever. Then so blocked, so the execution comes here. Okay, I escape from here, no problem. But now there is a problem. I am here, but I will block on Q. Okay, so blocked on Q because Q was minus one, as we established here. Okay, so what just happened here is a deadlock, because P0 is waiting for an event that will never occur, because the only thing that will make this event possible is the execution of signal Q. And the only way to go to signal Q is to escape from this wait. But again, this will not occur because this S is blocked, because signal S must be executed, but I am stuck here. So I wouldn't be able to read here. Okay, so this is the problem. So you are basically, and it causes starvation, like you can starve to death. Indefinite blocking, a process may never be removed from the semaphore's queue in which it is suspended. It will always be slipping, so it will get no service. So in your semaphore queue, if you are using a last in first out manner, then this may be a problem. But with the FIFO blocking, there is no problem. This is about starvation. Also, some low priority processes may cause high priority processes to wait. So if the semaphore of it is available, etc. So these are minor issues. Let's talk about other sync problems that I can solve with semaphores, okay? One is this bounded buffer problem. So these are nice applications. Actually, I will also show you some pictures here, like with the dining philosopher's problem, etc. But before going there, maybe I should also give another break here to help you refresh. I won't go to break. Actually, I will be here. So in this informal time, you are welcome to ask questions. And the formal third class will begin at 14:30. Okay, so I will stop the recording now and hang out here for a while. If you have questions, you can ask. And in the next official hour, we will start with the classical sync problems.